a sec. Do you reckon we should make up for starting late all those times by starting early today?
Are we early?
Well, it says it's only 9:28, 9:29. It's not really very early. Good morning, church. Good morning, good morning. And how is everyone today? Is everyone fed up? Because I know that I had an awesome meal last night. And I was sort of struggling at breakfast time this morning. And I thought, well,
breakfast?
Dinner
What's
was
breakfast?
Awfully good. So, I am a little bit fed up this morning, but in a good way. We had our Guess Who's Coming to Dinner last night, and so a whole bunch of us, we were getting together in small groups, having a really grand time. I know that the dinner that I had last night at my host's place went swimmingly. They have a pool. Anyway, what we will do right now is praise our King, because God is good.
All the time.
Is He not? God is the best, He's the greatest, He's the King, He's our Lord, He's our Savior. And I think it's about time that we stood up and had a time of praise and worship together. We'll sing, hopefully you'll dance and clap and shout and have a good time with us this morning. And Lord, as we come before you today, we thank you that you are here, you're in our midst, and you love us. And even though we can't comprehend the height, the width, and the depth of your love, we know that it is true, and we know that it conquers all. And so we thank you for your love this morning, and as we worship and as we pray, Lord, help us to just enjoy our time as a church family this morning, whether we're online or whether we're here in the house. Lord, we're all sort of bound together with you this morning. So we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right, let's stand and sing.
Church, God gave me this song. Said there's a time for the church to be humble and meek, and there's a time for the lion to roar, and where we speak as God directs our speech, there is power and there is might, and circumstances and environments will change. So don't hold back. If He asks you to do something, do it with the motivation of Christ, and there's freedom in a well-spoken word. sound of Jesus' name. Covered whole, hearts awake at the sound of Jesus' name. With singing, chains will fall, prisons shake at the sound of Jesus' name.
Who rules the
the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
This is how I fight my battles. This is how.
by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. 'Cause this is how I fight my battles. Let's sing it, Lord. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This mountain that's in front of me will be thrown into the midst of the sea. Through it all, my eyes are on you. Through it all is well. And through it all,
let it go, my soul, and trust. sustaining grace. I thank you for your strength, Lord, your power, your promise for tomorrow. I thank you for the hope that I hold for those around me. Help me to be bold and share it. Father, the same gift given to me, that I would offer it so that someone else may also have this strength, this freedom, this love, that they could hear the lion's roar on their behalf and know it is well. Amen.
Amen.
Amen, church.
Thank you for your love, Lord. And as we have Brian come this morning to take us around the table, Lord, we just come before you and we just want to say thank you. Please welcome Brian.
Welcome, Brian.
I should be on.
Thank you.
If you can't hear me, put your hand up.
He's the breaker.
In Luke 23, verse 46, we're told the moment that Jesus surrendered his spirit back to his Father, moments before he closed his eyes and breathed his last, he prayed. He said, "Father, into your hands I trust my spirit." But just prior to that event, he called out one word, which we are told was a Greek word, and is related to bookkeeping and accounting. That word, and I'm not a student of the Greek, so I hope I don't offend anybody here, but I pronounce as tetelestia, which translated into the English means "it is finished." In other words, our debt has been paid, the account is closed.
Amen.
It also has a deeper meaning. It's a declaration that all has been accomplished, the obligations met. No further action is needed.
Come on.
This generous statement and the actions that accompanied it meant that the way was now opened for followers of Jesus could now go forward secure in the knowledge that their debt of sin to God had been paid. Once and for all, the offer was to all the chosen people of God, the Jews, the children of Israel. The only condition to it was accepting Jesus as the long-awaited Messiah. However, this was rejected, and later it was offered to the Gentiles through the works of Apostle Paul. Although our debt of sin had been cancelled, there was another obligation. For God had given Moses a set of laws. Those laws, the Mosaic laws, were still on the statute books. And therefore, if we broke the law, even though we had no sin, there was a case against us that Satan could take into the courts of heaven and say he's broken the law. So, before anybody could enter into the new covenant of grace, the old covenant had to be dealt with. Our obligation under the Mosaic law still stood, And under the law, we would continue to carry that debt burden. As long as our obligation under the Mosaic law stood, our enemy would have rights to challenge us in the courts of heaven. This is why Jesus called out Telestai from the cross. He was satisfying our obligation under this law as well as relieving us from the burden of sin. Matthew 15:17 tells us that Jesus didn't come to abolish the law but to fulfill them. Jesus cleansed us of sin and freed us from the Old Testament laws. We were now free to enter into the New Testament, a testament of grace. At this point, it shows just how precise and carefully planned was God's great plan of redemption. By going to the cross on our behalf, he cleansed us from all judicials. He closed off all judicial attempts to use the old covenant to trap us.
Yeah.
We are now blood-bought children of God. Nothing by our own, but everything by him. Two issues of sin and law rob the enemy of any legal right to challenge us in the courts of heaven. The attention to detail in these events opened the way for us, for our salvation is just incredible. But it points to what is written in John 16, "For God so loved the world." We see from all this that God, through Jesus, through the crucifixion, had attended to every dot and every T, every I dotted, every T crossed. We were free from sin, free from legal obligations. We entered the New Testament with a clean slate, and this is the generosity of our God. This is his love, which says you could never do this on your own. You could obey the rules to the letter, but you could never do it. You would never succeed. But through Jesus going to the cross, I have done it for you. You are now children of the light. So this just, it touches your heart. It touches my heart to know that God's is so enamored with you and me, so we're so precious in his eyes that he would attend to such detail. And when we stand and we take these elements, remembering the cross, remembering Jesus' part in our salvation, remembering that the pain he suffered, the indignity, the torture, and finally the death. Gruesome as though that might sound, it was for your benefit, for my benefit, for our benefit. And we can now stand as children of the light, saved by the blood of the Lamb. So I invite you now to stand and take these elements in your own time and in your own way. Just remembering the body broken for you and the blood spilt for you, and how precious that is to a born-again Christian.
Thank you, Brian. We're going to come around a time of offering now as we continue our worship. And as I was contemplating our offering today, this week, I was struck by three things. The first thing is that primarily our offering is an act of worship. What we're doing when we include our wallet in our worship is we're saying, God, you're first. And we're putting God in the place where he deserves to be. And by enthroning God and by putting him in the place where he needs to be, that's what worship is. We're seeing God for who he is. We're acknowledging his role and his characteristics as being God. And it's that which is driving us to put him first in our finances. But offering is a little bit more than just an act of worship. In putting God in his place where he ought to be, it brings an alignment and helps us to be in the place where we need to be. So it's first and foremost an act of worship, but secondly, it's an act of alignment, because we're aligning ourselves in our finances with God. And there's benefits to that. There's blessings that flow when you're in alignment. When you're out of alignment, the blessings don't flow in quite the same way. And there's a number of passages in the scripture where God is challenging us to trust him with our finances, because who is it that is the source of what we have? Who is it that is the source of all things? Who is our supplier, really? It's our God who supplies everything we earn, everything we have, everything we need. And he can supply anything we could ask for or even imagine. But it's through alignment that we get the supply. So this morning, as we come with our money, our tithes, our love offerings, and as we offer those as an act of worship, and as we bring ourselves into an alignment, Lord, we just say thank you. We thank you for the blessings that you have given us. We thank you for your hand upon our lives. And as we look back, we thank you for all the times that we have seen your hand at work. And Lord, as we come today, we know that you have divine purposes and kingdom purposes for that which we are giving to you today. And for that, we thank you, and we pray for wisdom for those who will see these funds distributed appropriately. And Lord, for the days ahead, we thank you for your supply. We know that you are our supply. And as we align ourselves with you today, we expect the blessings that are coming our way in the days ahead. And we just thank you for them right now. Mighty God, Heavenly Father, thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, church. And I thank those who were so diligent in taking up the offering without any actual specific prompting from me, which is one of the things that I practiced this week and completely forgot. Awesome. But we're a family, aren't we? Awesome. There's a few things that we need to just have a quick chat about today. But before we sort of get going too much, I think we need to acknowledge some birthdays. I can't see any birthdays on my little sheet. Does that mean we don't have any birthdays today? Okay, put your hand up if you got your birthday coming up this week. I see those hands online, maybe. Well, better luck next week then. We'll pray for all of those who have their birthday next week on next Sunday. We do have some upcoming events, so I'll jump straight into those. Who knows when the 12th of December is?
Saturday.
The 12th of December is this coming Saturday. Anyone want to have a guess as to what's on Saturday? Markets, Christmas markets. I tell you what, the Christmas markets are pretty big in Mareeba, and we're going to have a wonderful workforce selling bacon and egg burgers. If you want to be a part of that and help bless our community and raise some money for missions, then I suggest you get in contact with the office. Office hours are normally between 9 and 1. I'm sure that if you can't ring in that period of time, just find Daryl's number. He'd love to hear from you. Otherwise, you can catch up with one of the charming leaders after church and put your name down, and we'll make sure that everyone gets a turn on the roster. We don't want anyone to miss out, so make sure you get your name down quick. Okay, we have a couple of things coming up in the lead up to Christmas. So I hope everyone has got their bells ready to jingle, got their candles ready to wave. We've got a special time that we're going to have in Mount Garnet, because we're going to visit them. And we're going to have a wonderful Christmas, end of year, community celebration, service in Mount Garnet. And that is the 20th of December. So it's a Sunday. It's in the evening. We'll be heading over there kind of in the late afternoon-ish, I'm guessing. But the service up there will start, I think it's 7, is it? Or is it 6? I was going to say. 7 might be a bit late, might be 6.
Barbecue at 5,
service at 6. We're kind of hoping that we can get a decent contingent to go up there and just have some fun with the Garnet guys and be a blessing to them and encourage them. They're always a very encouraging bunch, so I know that if you come along with us, you'll be blessed too. And so that's the 20th of December. The other service that we're having is on Christmas Eve. So we're having our Christmas Day service just a little bit early, and we're having a carols night on Christmas Eve. We're going to be inviting the whosoevers from the community who want to come and join us to sing a few Christmas carols and celebrate what is a wonderful time of year to remember who Jesus really is and what he came for. So celebrate with us on that night. We're going to be outside if it's fine. Pray for the weather, because we really want to be outside and we really want it to be fine. We'll be having an awesome time. That does start at 7 o'clock. It'll be a 7 until 8:30 Christmas carols. Fun for the whole family. It won't be a particularly late night. But we do want to have a good time and show our community that Christmas is a little bit special. The council aren't running the normal sort of carols evening this year. It's a really good opportunity to invite people along. We'll have plenty of room, and it'll be really good to have plenty of people here. So on Christmas Day, we will not have a service. The heart of our church is that Christmas is focused on family. And so by not having a service, it allows those who need to travel to catch up with family to do so without feeling like they're missing out on a service here. For those who don't have anywhere to go on Christmas and would like to have a Christmas family lunch, we would love to celebrate that time with you here. If you don't have friends and family that are close enough to visit, if you're going to be alone, don't be. We're a family, and we'd love to have that time with you on Christmas Day to celebrate together. If you want more information about that Christmas Day lunch, please see Elizabeth. If you want to RSVP for that, please contact either Elizabeth or the church office. And it is important that you do RSVP. We'd rather not have too many walk-ins on the day. We want to make sure that we're well prepared for that function. So please let us know. please RSVP by Friday the 18th of December. There you go. I've even got additional information. There are some little flyers around if you're looking for that. And this is the Christmas Eve carols service information. Get a hold of that. Give one to your neighbour. Give one to your other neighbour. Take some to work. Put them on the lunch table. See who comes along. That's our announcements. I'm not getting the glare from Pastor Trish, so I must have done all right. What I want to do now is just invite a few people to come up and give a testimony. We all had a really good time last night, those of us who were guests or hosts and went out to dinner. And I know that there were some special times had. I know we had some really special time together where I was last night. And so I'll start. But anyone who wants to just share a little bit about last night, get your skates on. Come and line up on this side of the stage in an orderly single file, please. And we'll give you all a minute or two just to share what you want to from last night. But I did mention earlier at the start of the service that ours went swimmingly. Our hosts had a pool. And so we were invited to rock up just a little bit early and jump in the pool and have a dip. And it was just really good time to spend together. Our hosts had a lovely little game that we played to get to know each other just a little bit better and find out some facts about each other that you wouldn't normally share. Just through sharing some of the weird things that you do in life, it's amazing how much you can learn about someone. And probably one of our most precious moments was my youngest daughter, Liana, and what she decided to share with everyone about herself and some of the favourite things that she likes to do. One of her favourite things is to make gifts for other people. And we just had such a special time as we were hearing some of those really just sharing from the heart amongst friends in a lovely little group. Yeah, my dear darling daughter Liana stole the show a little bit last night just because she's got such a beautiful heart and the things that she shared. So who's next? I feel like there's no one lining up.
I'm here already.
Oh, well, perfect. Mrs. Young.
Well, our dinner was very quiet and refined. And who am I kidding? It was at my house. Actually, ours was more like gladiators. Liza came in her chariot and the kids were bludgeoning each other in the pool. I think it's an amazing thing to just deliberately surround yourself with friends, isn't it?
Yeah.
To choose your friends and surround yourself with them. And it was a beautiful, beautiful night. And everything was quiet and peaceful till Beck brought her pavlova out and Adrian got into it. No, but it's lovely. It's always good to surround yourself with friends. And we had the best night. Kicked everyone out at 9 so we could actually sleep. But yeah, really, really encouraging. Great time to get together and just enjoy each other. And those puzzles that you guys put in the envelopes were bomb diggity. They were really hard. One of them we sat there, have you got that? Titus took us a long time to find.
Yes, grab a microphone.
Hello, we went to Lillian and Brian Stevens, and Lillian sang for us. Oh, it was, and we had a lovely time with Takura, and Trevor came too. It was very nice. Beautiful food, pavlova.
We do have a cordless microphone. Maybe if I'm down here, I can help facilitate better.
Yes, well, I went to Michelle and Ross's, and there was nine of us actually, and we had a great, great time. Food was amazing. We had so much food, and that's why I got my tent dress on today. Yeah, so we had a really great time. It was extra special for me actually because Phil left on Friday to go back to PNG, and he'll be away probably for 2 months. And just last night, I came home feeling really happy, and because I had such a good time. So thank you, everybody.
Awesome. Does anyone else want to share? I may not, or may or may not be looking at people specifically. Have we had at least one from every group yet?
No, come on, everyone else who was there. We went to Helen and Greg's place, I see Greg, and it was good. And Basil and I got lost on our way there and went down Morganberry Road and ended up at the causeway and then had to go all the way around. And so we kind of had an adventure as well. But it was a good night. The food was amazing. And just, you know, there's that pause where everyone's like, so what are we doing here? And I decided to ask, where does everybody hail from? And all of a sudden, we had all these amazing testimonies from everybody about far out their whole life story and like where the Lord took them and all this stuff, and it was actually fantastic. And I'm looking for faces who were there, and Greg is the only person I see. Hello. So yeah, it was actually a really great night, and we kind of had a sense that we got to know each other a lot better, which was kind of the purpose of the evening.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Thank you. We had somebody who got lost. There she is. I won't name her, but but she got there before it was time to start, so she wasn't really lost, was she? She was just the last one to arrive. And the only problem we had was that the table wasn't big enough for the food that we shared. It was really, really delicious. And Sarah brought a dish from Wanuatu, which was triple delicious. We were very grateful for that, and everybody had something there, so everybody was contributing in the food and in the conversation and the love and the sharing, and it was just an excellent night. Thank you.
Awesome.
Daryl, myself, Tom and Anton went to Bert and Jeanette's in Herberton. We had a great time up there. It was a real Christmas feast. The boys were checking out Bert's car that he's doing up. What is it, Bert? Sorry?
The big truck,
F-250. And they're checking out Jeanette's garden, which is beautiful. I didn't get to see it. The men went wandering and Jeanette and I were in the kitchen. But other than that, it was a beautiful time. We greatly appreciated it, Bert and Jeanette.
Yeah, nice.
Fantastic. Michelle.
I just want to thank everyone. Mainly I want to thank our Heavenly Father, because I think we were truly blessed by the whole event. And I thank Dave and Elizabeth for suggesting it. Thank you, Pastor and Daryl and Trish, for helping all that. Mel for helping in the office. But I just want to thank all the hosts, and I want to thank all the guests, because I think we've all got a bit of an extra skip in our step this morning, because we've actually fellowshiped with people. We've got to know people that we haven't really spent a lot of time with, and I think it was just a really enriching time. So thank you, everyone.
Yeah.
Awesome. And isn't it what family's all about? Awesome. Next, do you want to come up here? Or I'm going to come back there. We'll give anyone who wants a chance to speak.
Hello. I pop into this church every now and again, and it's lovely. I love the atmosphere here. I would just like to share that yesterday I have a friend up from Brisbane, She's a missionary in Papua. And she had lived in Atherton 40 years ago. So we invited a friend over that she had known 40 years ago. And it was just amazing to sit there and listen to them share, because I have known the Atherton lady for 30 years, but what the lady from Brisbane drew out of her was just wonderful to be part of. And I think this is where the Holy Spirit is so beautiful, that he organises situations where you can sit and just read the book that each one of us are.
Yeah, it's good.
Awesome. And it's great to hear how everyone was able to find a good time, find some people to share with. And I know that there was a lot of honesty at the dinner that I was at. And it's just really good when you're able to be yourself and be genuine and get to know each other just that little bit better. Margaret.
A little bit scared, but anyway. I went where Gary went, and we were told, or I was told by Michelle, that where we were going was there was a pool, and I thought there's only a couple of people with pools. And so my mind was racing, and then who I thought it was when we got to the door and somebody opened it, because instead of Andrew, my grandson, coming with us, he was a little bit not well, and so my daughter came with us instead and she really enjoyed herself. But anyway, when we got to the house and I thought it was someone going to open the door, it wasn't. Peter opened it instead. So it was Peter and Michelle and Daniel, and we had a great time with Gary and Mel and all their kids. And yeah, the meal was good, but what really touched my heart was we took Mia with us, and she's been going through a lot of stuff, and Michelle opened her heart up to her and talked to her, and when we were outside and inside, and Mia said to me, she's been other places but never felt like she did last night. She felt very at ease, and so I just want to say thank you to Michelle for what you did for me last night. It meant a lot. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Oh, why don't we just pray? Lord God, we just thank you for the time that we were able to have last night with family, with friends, and with you. We thank you that you were at each of those hosts' houses last night, and that you were permeating through. And as we enjoyed ourselves, Lord, and as we enjoyed the company, we just thank you for the way in which you were able to connect us and draw each one out. And as we continue to develop these relationships that we have, that we've formed and that we're continuing to form, and as we continue to be a family, God, help us as we just continue to love each other and serve you, that we might always be an encouragement to those around us, and that as we seek to love and serve you, that we know that you say in your word that we will be known. How do we know that we are your church? For the love that we have one for another. How will the people of Mareeba, how will our community know that we are true Christians? Because of the love that we have and the love that we show. And so we just thank you, and we pray that as we continue to meet together, and as we continue to find ourselves in our life groups and our cell groups, Lord, that you'll just continue to let our relationships blossom and grow. In Jesus' name we say, thank you, Lord. Amen. I'm going to ask Pastor Darrell to come now. Pretty tough act to beat, some of those testimonies, Pastor.
Hey, good morning, church. Maranatha, the Lord is coming, amen. In the meantime, we've got a great work to do. It's great to see you all here this morning. I just want to thank you for praying for Trish and I last week. We're in Weeper, and we arrived, and as normal, I said to Pastor Semi, because you never know what's going to happen when you turn up, in a sense. And I said, okay, how many meetings have we got? He said, one. I thought, oh, okay, one. He said, yeah, I just want to spend time with you. And so I want you to know, a lot of times senior leaders just need someone to come alongside and have a coffee. Amen? Yeah. And maybe you're like that too. So we're all no different. We all enjoy a little bit of encouragement. Sometimes we just need to talk. But I just want to complain about last night, because I was too scared to get on the scales this morning. What a meal we had. Unbelievable. But anyway, this morning, I want us to look at Isaiah 40. I believe the Holy Spirit wants to speak to us and wants you to have a fresh revelation about who God is this morning. And secondly, to learn to soar with Him. Holy Spirit, we just thank you that you're the one that enables. You're the one that anoints our ears and our eyes and our heart that we'd understand. So we just pray together this morning that you be the teacher and you be the one that brings revelation. You be the one that speaks to us in such a way that we leave here built up, encouraged, but Lord, willing to embrace what you are speaking to us. In Jesus' name we ask. As we turn to Isaiah 40, we're going to look at the first two verses. It says, comfort, yes, comfort my people, says your God. So this is God speaking to Isaiah, and Isaiah speaking this. God says, speak comfort to Jerusalem and cry out to her, that her warfare is ended, that her iniquity is pardoned, for she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. I just want to give you a little bit of understanding. Isaiah, in the first 39 chapters, most of those chapters is all about judgment and warnings. Then all of a sudden, from chapter 40 onwards, we're looking at God wanting to bring comfort and promise to hearts. As we look at this from a theologian point of view, I suppose chapters 1 to 35 are very prophetic with the theme of condemnation. And then from chapters 36 to 39, they're historic, and the theme is confiscation. But from chapters 40 to 66 are all messianic, means they're all referring or revealing Christ to us. And that theme is consolation. So as we begin this chapter, we perceive very quickly that God desires without measure that His people would receive comfort. I want you to understand afresh this morning that your Father so cares about you. Whether you know Him this morning or don't, His love and care for you is immeasurable and wants you to experience His comfort. In the second book of Corinthians, chapter 1, verse 3, I often remind people in funerals about this truth. The Word of God says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies, hallelujah, and the Father of God of all comfort. Do you know Him as such this morning? Who comforts us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort those who are in any trouble with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. Beloved, right now as we approach Christmas, we need to be reminded that there is a community out there of broken people. There's a community out there that need what you have received. And here in this passage of Scripture, Jerusalem needed a word of comfort, as each of you and I do at times. As Christians, as a child of God, as a son or daughter of the Most High God, we need to be real in saying that at times we feel defeated. At times we feel overwhelmed with the pressures of life. At times we feel weak. At times we feel smashed. At times we feel broken. Amen? But the Holy Spirit always cries out to us and declares the battle's been won. Declares, let the truth of the cross comfort you. And we can say, what, Holy Spirit? I don't feel that right now. I feel like just, you know, the dead ant. You ever did the dead ant on someone? Get on your back, put your legs and feet in the air. You know, you just got nothing more to offer. You know, you feel like that at times as a Christian. But the Holy Spirit, isn't he wonderful? Isn't he amazing how he comes alongside and whispers into our ears? But I tell you what. He does. He takes us back to when you first got saved. He takes us back to understanding that we were pardoned. And this was a comfort that the prophet was speaking to Jerusalem. You and I deserve to die in our sins, amen? But through the crucifixion, through the death of the Lord Jesus Christ upon that cross, we were forgiven. Amen? We traded our filthy, sinful, unrighteous life, hallelujah, for his righteousness and his life. How blessed are we? I'm here to remind you this morning that God is a God of all comfort. In Colossians chapter 2, verse 13 to 14, I love this passage of scripture. Because it declares, and you being dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, that's what you were until you gave your life to Christ. He says, now he's made you alive together with him, having forgiven all your trespasses. The goodness of God doesn't just forgive us. He forgets what you've done. He chooses to forget what you've done. Hallelujah. The devil reminds you what you did, but God never will. I nearly said your wife reminds you now and again, but no, we won't go there. Amen? Boy, I nearly slipped up, eh? So it goes on to say, having wiped out the requirements, handwriting of requirements that was against us, which was contrary to us, and he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. Come on, we need to always, and it's interesting, one of the songs that said this morning, we sang this morning, was just that, about him surrounding our life. Romans 8 verse 37 says, yet in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. At times, I don't feel like a conqueror, do you? But hallelujah, the word of God says you are. Turn to your neighbor and say, you're a conqueror, come on. 1 John 4 4 says, you are of God, little children, and have overcome them because he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. Come on. So to know God as a God of all comfort always comes back to what God's word says. As we read verse 3 of this 40th chapter to 5, the word of God says, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be exalted and every mountain and hill brought low. The crooked places shall be made straight and the rough places smooth. The glory of the Lord shall be revealed and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. This passage relates to John the Baptist and his ministry. The Gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke relate to this passage. Any great work of God begins with great preparation. Every great man or woman of God has years of preparation before released in the ministry. But today, I want to remind you this morning that God is preparing his church for an end-time harvest. So if you're wondering what's going on in your life right now, why the shaking? Why the battle? Why? Let me tell you, God's got you in preparation time. Preparation time. I don't know about you, but I don't like the preparation time. You know, we live in a microwave world, and I like to have something just ready in a few minutes. But I watched my wife prepare some of the food for last night, and it was hours. And I would like to say I helped her, but I didn't. I had a meeting, so I got excuses. But I want you to get into what Isaiah's saying here this morning and relate it to your life. Because as we move into this chapter, verse 6 to 8 says this, the voice said, cry out. And he said, what shall I cry? All flesh is grass, and all its loveliness is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades, because the breath of the Lord blows upon it. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. This is a passage that compares the fragility of man with the permanence of the word of God. The beauty of man is fleeting, the word of God is saying here to us. That means lasting for a very short time. Your life on earth is very short time compared to eternity. Amen. God himself is called the Ancient of Days. The word says, "And the beauty of man is fleeting and passes as quickly as spring wildflowers. But the word of God, beloved, stands forever. It has survived all these centuries, even though at one time it was copied and recopied on material that perished until the invention of the printing press. But you and I can still pick up the Bible today, amen? It's amazing how God has been so faithful with his word. In 303 AD, that's 303 years after the birth of Christ, Roman Emperor Diocletian demanded that every copy of the scriptures in the Roman Empire be burnt. I think he failed in his endeavor, amen? There was a man called Voltaire. He's a French skeptic, and you could call him a lot of other things, who died in 1778. He said that Christianity would not exist 100 years from his time. Many years after his death, the Geneva Bible Society used his press and his house to produce stacks of Bibles. Come on. I want to stir you up this morning about the Word of God, because it's the Word that brings comfort. In 1 Peter chapter 1, 23 to 25, the Word of God says, having been born again, he's talking about you, if you've given your life to Christ, you received him as your Savior, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible, through the Word of God, which lives and abides forever. Because all flesh is as grass, and all the glory of man as the flower of the grass. The grass withers and its flower falls away, but the word of the Lord endures forever. Now, Apostle Peter says, this is the word which by the gospel was preached to you. Apostle Peter here makes a beautiful connection showing that the enduring word Isaiah spoke of is the same word of the gospel that is preached and believed, bringing salvation. Come on, church. As we continue through Isaiah here, verse 9 to 14 says this. O Zion, you who bring good tidings, get up into the high mountain, O Jerusalem. You who bring good tidings, lift up your voice with strength. Lift it up, be not afraid. Say to the cities of Judah, behold your God. In other words, shout it as loud as you can. Proclaim it from the highest place. Let it go out throughout all of the cities of Judah. Behold your God. Goes on to say, behold, the Lord God shall come with a strong hand, and his arm shall rule for him. Behold, his reward is with him and his work before him. He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs with his arm and carry them in his bosom, and gently lead those who are with young. Who has measured the waters in the hollow of his hand, measured heaven with a span, and calculated the dust of the earth in a measure, weighed the mountains in scales and the hills in a balance, who has directed the Spirit of the Lord? Who has directed the Spirit of the Lord? Or, as his counselor has taught him, with whom did he take counsel, and who instructed him and taught him in the path of justice? Who taught him knowledge and showed him the way of understanding? There's a lot there about God that you and I need to understand. But the prophet is saying afresh to you and bringing that into our time on earth, the invitation is still there to behold your God. Behold means to observe someone or something, especially of remarkable or impressive nature. So God's saying to you and I afresh this morning, don't glance at me. Don't just take a quick look, but behold me. You know, I couldn't get over last night because Bert and Jeanette have done such an amazing work up there on their property. But what attracted me and amazed me was all these plants were all flowering. Do you see any flowers around Mareeba? I tell you, it's just one pot plant, and the pot plants are like so. One after that, just flower upon flower upon flower. I beheld that. I'm just looking at it. You know, my Pastor Rick, he teased me that through the week. He rang me and said, by the way, we're sitting here, they're looking at the sunset. And I was looking at my wall. And I said, that's very unfair. But they sit there because I've sat with them too and just beheld the sunset. Well, God wants you to behold him afresh. You understand what the Spirit of God is saying here? The first thing he wants you to behold, the returning Lord. That passage of Scripture said the Lord's coming. Of course, it's referring to a messianic, but it's also referring to you and I this morning. There will be a rapture coming. In chapter 4 of 1 Thessalonians, I just want to stir your heart a little bit this morning. This. It says, for the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And last we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. Come on, Maranatha. The Lord comes. So the scripture's saying here, behold that. Look at that. Don't just take a glance and say, well, you know, maybe he's coming back. Get it in your spirit. If you don't understand, do a study on it. The scripture goes on here to say to behold him as a loving shepherd. Oh, he is a loving shepherd. Amen. Behold him as creator. Come on, we need to do that. I'm just a Mazer, I remember when I lived up at Dimbula, Machuba, every time we came to church on a Sunday, we just, whoa, look at God's creation. Some mornings it was just, I don't know how the guys came coming down from the mule this morning. But we should just look at that and think, wow, how could anyone think there's not a creator? Goes on to say, behold him as the God of all wisdom. That means no, just don't take a glance, but look into that. Amen? You with me this morning? Because I need a drink of water, please. As we go into Isaiah 40, this is for me this morning while I'm preaching, okay? Because I was going to preach something else and God began to speak to me on this. And I was having such a great fun time, I thought I'd better share it. In verse 15 it says, behold, means take notice again, the nations are as a drop in a bucket and are counted as a small dust on the scales. Look, he lifts up the isles as a very little thing. And Lebanon is not sufficient to burn, nor its beast sufficient for a burnt offering. All nations before him are as nothing, and they are counted by him less than nothing and worthless. I just want to remind you this morning that the God you serve, the Father of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and the Father of you this morning, his greatness surpasses all the greatness any nation can manifest. Any nation, whether it be USA, Russia, China, you name it, England, you name it, Germany in the day. I remember seeing those old films. The army was amazing. But the Word of God says, God's greatness surpasses anything that a nation can look like or even do. Goes on to say in verse 18, and to whom then will you liken God? Or what likeness will you compare him to or compare to him? The workman molds an image. The goldsmith overspreads it with gold, and the silversmith casts silver chains. Whoever is too impoverished for such a contribution chooses a tree that will not rot. He seeks for himself a skillful workman to prepare a carved image that will not totter. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth. Isn't it amazing? Centuries later, they thought the earth was flat, but Isaiah's telling them, see, now the earth's round. And its inhabitants are like grasshoppers. Who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them out like a tent to dwell in? He brings the princes to nothing. He makes the judges of the earth useless. Scarcely shall they be planted. Scarcely shall they be sown. Scarcely shall their stock take root in the earth, when he will also blow on them and they will wither. And the whirlwind will take them away like stubble. To whom then will you liken me? Or to whom shall I be equal? Says the Holy One. Lift up your eyes on high and see who has created all these things. Who brings them out their host by number. He calls them by all by name, by the greatness of his might and the strength of his power. Not one is missing. This is your God. God's greatness surpasses not only whatever a nation could be in the eyes of man, but his greatness makes everything else just fade away, and especially idols. Isaiah could not believe that man makes something with his own hands and then worships it. To you and I who have had our eyes opened, realize how crazy that is. To carve an image that won't totter and then worship it, and it can't even stand on its own. And yet man worships it. Isaiah could not believe that anyone could doubt the greatness of God when they see the glory of God's creation. How they could not believe that a glorious designer was not behind such a glorious design. It amazes me that billions and billions of stars in the universe, and God can number them and name them. He's your dad. He's the one that wants to comfort you. He's the one that wants to partner with you. Understanding the greatness and the glory of God helps us to believe that nothing in our life is hidden from God. Nothing in this nation is hidden from God. Whatever happens in government is not hidden by God. What's happening in America right now is not hidden by God or anywhere else. Amen? It brings comfort to us. Verse 27 of this chapter says, talking to Israel, "Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my just claim is passed over by my God?" You see, Israel stopped believing that God cared. Stopped believing that he wasn't even bothering to look anymore. They stopped believing that he could see they're going out and they're coming in. But I want to declare over our lives this morning, that's not what who we are. Amen? In Hebrews chapter 4, verse 13, the Word of God says, "There is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give an account." So with all that I've shared this morning, which we've traveled very quickly through Isaiah chapter 40, I want to ask you a question. I believe the Holy Spirit wants to ask us a question. If you know all that about God, why do you not wait on him? As we finish the last few verses of Isaiah, verse 28 says this, "Have you not known? Have you not heard the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, neither faints nor is weary? His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the weak, and to those who have no might, he increases strength. Even the youths shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. But those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint." As we come into this season of time on this earth, as believers, we must make this a lifestyle. It doesn't take too long as a Christian to understand that we are weak. And without God enabling, without his empowering, without his wonderful work in our life, I know I probably wouldn't be here today. And many times we get weary and we need God to touch our life. The word weary, the Hebrew meaning here, is exhaustion because of hardness of life. I don't think there would be one testimony in this room this morning that said, "Well, I just had such an easy life. I don't know what everyone else is complaining about. It's just so easy." I know this, beloved. What can hinder me pressing into God, waiting upon the Lord, is pride. Because pride will convince me that everything is okay and I can do it in my own strength. I'm no longer a young man, so I know that I need God more than ever. But, you know, it says here that even young men, if they try to live this life in their own strength, it's not going to, they're going to fail. As a young man, you're convinced you could do anything. Amen? You're 6 feet across the shoulders and about 12 foot tall, and you're going to do everything. But if I can speak to the young men this morning, as well as the older men and women, if you can get an understanding of this morning, that you need to build a lifestyle where you wait upon the Lord, you will walk in God's strength all your life. He or she who waits on the Lord shall renew their strength. They will soar with Jesus. They will run the race of faith and walk the walk. We always come across people who can talk the talk. Amen? But you and I have a race to run. It's a race of faith. Why do you not wait on me? Asked the Lord. Why do you not wait on me? If God is everything that we've heard this morning and more, we only touched a little bit about God, didn't we? Why would we not wait on Him? To wait means in the Hebrew, K-A-V-A. I'm not too sure how to pronounce it. Kava, maybe. But it's actually waiting and looking with expectancy. To wait is to seek Him and wait for the prompting of the Holy Spirit or the Holy Spirit to give you revelation or an answer or even speak to your heart on what you must do. It's interesting that in this passage of Scripture it refers to us as that if we wait on the Lord, we'll just begin to rise as an eagle rises. Above everything. The Word of God says you and I are seated with Christ Jesus in heavenly places. That's the place of authority spiritually. But you know, even an eagle, he can't just flap his wings and take off. He can't do that. He has to wait for the thermal currents. He has to wait. And when he feels the thermal lifting, then he begins to rise. It's no different to you and I. That's why Scripture refers to this waiting upon the Lord and referring it to an eagle. You'll rise as an eagle. An eagle can soar, I'm told, to around 4,500 meters. Well, let's say 4,000 meters. I'm told normal flights around 30 kilometers an hour. But from a height, when they see something, they can fly coming down around 120 kilometers an hour. That's not bad for if any, I don't know if the eagle's got any policemen or anything. But their eyesight is amazing. You realize that the eyesight is amazing. I nearly went miles because I think miles sometimes. But they can look for 80 kilometers and see another eagle soaring. Can you imagine trying to, as you're growing up in that eagle family, and you're trying to do something you shouldn't do, and mum says, I can still see you. I want you to get an understanding that you and I need to soar. It talks about the prophetic. It talks about being in the spirit. We need to wait in his presence. I said to Bert last night, I was so almost jealous of Apostle John on the island of Patmos. Here he is imprisoned. He can't go anywhere else. He's on the island of Patmos. But he says, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. He must have lived the life of being in the Spirit. He just had to make it a certain day. The focus is on the day. But I want you to focus a minute. He was a man who knew how to move in the Spirit. You and I are Spirit. And we need to understand that God is Spirit and He speaks to your spirit. And if you just live a carnal life, you'll never ever experience the soaring with Jesus. Number one, we need the baptism of the Holy Ghost to enable us to know how to touch God in this way. But to be in the Spirit, I'm just going to quickly give you a little what I do. Because I want to so encourage you in a sense that God wants you to practice this until it becomes a lifestyle. And it's very clear that God has enough strength or enough power or enough whatever you need to impart to your life. But it's clear that you need to wait on Him to receive it. Amen? So my encouragement, if I can give you an early Christmas present, is let's review our devotional life. How strong is your devotional life? Have you built a devotional life? A devotional life starts with consistency of seeking the Lord. You know, we sang about the table this morning. There was a time when King David, it says in the Bible, where Saul noticed, King David was supposed to be at the table, and Saul noticed that he wasn't there the first day, and the second day, and the third day, didn't say no, but the fourth day he says, where's David? I wonder how many times God says, where's Daryl? Because it's like coming to his table, waiting upon the Lord. And therefore, you need to set a time when you do that. It's just you and God, not you and the family, not you and your wife or your husband. It's just you spending time with God, waiting on Him. My first couple of hours in a day are always, that's my focus. If I'm not there in the morning, I think God would think I was dead. Because I've built that. I've had to build that. And I want to encourage you to build that. When's the time you can get with God? Even if it starts off in 30 minutes. Amen? But this is what I do. I got a chair at home. I got to move it from one to a place to another so I can be away. I don't wake Trish up, all those things. And I just sit in that chair. You know, before I get there, God's already dropping songs in my heart. And when you've been saved since 85, I've got a lot of songs. You know what a song He dropped in my heart as I walking to hop in that chair this morning? This is my desire. You know that old song? I just began to worship the Lord and it just flows from there. But it's taken me a while to build that. But I sit in that chair and you know what the first thing I begin to do? I thank God for Calvary. I thank God for the blood of Jesus Christ that was shed for me. I begin to go there. I thank God for the blood. There's a power in heaven, and it's the blood of Christ. Amen. The blood speaks in the courts of heaven for your life and my life. I was once away from God. Today, I'm a son. Whatever your situation, I tell you, I give God thanks for that. The very first thing I do, I begin to praise Him for that in amongst worship. In amongst singing in tongues and all the rest, I begin to pray for my family before I go anywhere else. And if God puts anything on my heart, I pray there. But I'm waiting on Him to direct me. And then I open up the Word of God. Because it's so important for you to read the Word of God. It feeds your spirit. I fed the flesh really good last night, I can tell you. But there's times in your life you need to really feed your spirit real good. I expect God to speak to me in the Word. For some people, we call it journaling. If you want to journal and if you want to learn how to do that, come see me or see someone else who does it. But journaling is a joy. And so let me show you how that works. Can I have that last passage of Scripture up? I'm going to believe God to speak to your heart this morning out of the Scripture. That's fine. Is that 28? Let's just go on the last one, verse 31. Let's read it together. And let's believe God to speak to your heart. But those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. I'm going to pray and then we're going to read it again. Father, I know You are stirring us up to be a people that waits upon You. Whether those who are watching online or in this building this morning, or over in the chapel, we just pray, O God, that You would speak to us through this Word. You do speak differently to all of us. And we thank You for Your work, Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name. Let's read it again. For those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not weary. They shall walk and not faint. Let's just meditate upon that for 30 seconds. Give us a way that you feel God spoke to you something out of that passage of Scripture. Ron, would you like to just quickly share what you... Oh, wow. Colleen, what did the Lord say to you? Awesome. Anyone else? One more. Yes, John. Amen. So I want you to understand that when God's speaking to you, whether it be Ron, Colleen, or John, God's speaking to them. It becomes intimate in that sense. And so a lot of my devotional work is between me and God. It's very intimate, very private. But God speaks to you. I used to think God was speaking to me for others. Anyone else think that? You know, my wife really needed to hear something here. But I'm here to this morning to stir us up, to grow this. I get so excited. I reckon if we grab the passage of Scripture or whatever, we'd all come up with where God is speaking to you personally. It's very personal. Amen? And so what I do in that place is times after I read the Scripture or through the day, I might just stop and wait on the Lord. So it's not just for a devotion life, for waiting and seeking the Lord on things. It's, Lord, what have you got to say? I've got a lot to say. I've got a lot of things I should tell God what he should be doing for my life. Amen. But what's God saying? I asked Tricia this morning, we heard a story about this woman who had 10 children. And when they saw her sitting with the apron pulled up over her head, thy children knew not to mess with mum. Why? Because mum was waiting upon the Lord. Mum was, may have been downloading strength or just downloading revelation. Yesterday morning, I just sat in my chair and God surprised me because straight away I got download. Think, oh. Come on, I want to so get you excited about waiting upon the Lord, because this will be what will keep you in the days ahead of us. Amen? Let's stand with me as the musicians come, please. So be reminded this morning of who God is, but be reminded that if you can build this in your life, if it's got a bit weak, come on, let's get this strong again. If it hasn't even begun, it's okay. Start today. Amen? Start today. Lift your hands, if you will, to heaven. Father, we just thank you that you do see us as conquerors, because you're within us. Greater is he that's within us than he that's in the world. But as we've learned afresh that you are a God of all comfort, I pray today, Lord, if anyone's in this house or watching, if they're feeling broken, if they're feeling busted, if they're feeling, oh God, so weak and defeated, I pray, oh God, that you would just pour out upon their lives in such a way that they would experience the Heavenly Father who is the God of all comfort. Comfort, I pray, Lord, those that need comfort today. But Father, as we've understood this morning that we need to be a people beholding you, we ask forgiveness where we've just glanced at you, where we've just took a quick look at you. But we pray, oh God, that as we repent and turn away from that you would just so grace us, we would be a people that behold you. That we will Search your word. But in all that, oh God, as we understand your greatness and your goodness, we choose today to wait upon you. Please forgive us where we have not done what we used to do. But today, oh God, we repent and we ask you to help us to establish this again in our life. Let us be a people known as those who wait upon the Lord. So Spirit of God, break off each one of us any discouragement, any disappointment, any sense that we've failed you or failed ourselves or others. Let this be a new day. As I decree it, declare it over our lives, this is a new day. We can never replace what's been, but oh Lord, we can embrace you in this new day. And we reach out to you right now, Holy Spirit, to strengthen us and empower us and give us strategy even on how to establish and build in our life this lifestyle. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. And we all say, amen, amen. Whether you're online or here this morning, we'd love to pray with you in whatever way. So, beloved, if you're here, you like prayer, we'll open up the altar in a moment. Or you can just come now if you like. But as we sing this, I'm going to ask Gary to, following the song, to close the service. But it would be remiss of me if I never gave you an opportunity to give your life to Christ if you're here this morning. And you're never giving your life to Christ if you're online and you're never giving your life to Christ. Let me encourage you with this comforting of the scripture that says, those who receive him, he gives them the power to become a child of God. If you believe in your heart, the Lord Jesus Christ, that he died on a cross for you, shed his blood for you, that you may have forgiveness of sins from the Father, be reconciled to the Father. If you believe he's the Son of the living God, I'm going to pray this prayer and ask you to follow after me. And if you're in the house, I ask you to follow after me as well. Let's pray this together. Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
Thank you for dying on the cross for me.
Thank you for dying on the cross for me.
I am so sorry that I've sinned against you.
I'm so sorry I've sinned against you.
I choose today to turn away from my sinful life.
I choose today to turn away from my sinful life.
And I turn to you, Lord.
I turn to you, Lord.
Please forgive me of all my sin.
Please forgive me of all my sin.
Come into my life.
Come into my life.
Be my Savior.
Be my Savior.
Be my friend.
Be my friend.
Be my King.
Be my King.
I receive you today.
I receive you today.
And as your word declares.
And as your word declares.
I am now a child of God.
I am now a child of God.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's worship together.
There's a table that you're prepared for me in the presence of my enemies. It's your body and your blood you've shed for me, and this is how I fight my battle. Sing it again. There's a table that you're prepared for me in the presence of my enemies. It's your body and your blood you've shed for me. This is how I fight my battle. Yeah. And I will lift my song of praise.
you're with me. Surely your goodness, your mercy follow me. So my weapons are used in thanksgiving. This is how I fight my
upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Join us outside for some fellowship. Thank you so much for joining us online. We'll see you next Sunday or Saturday. Thank you.
the midst of the sea.